Now let's look at the catching away as we conclude the chapter. Verse 39, now when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. And Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. That word caught Philip away is the same word that we use for the rapture in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Same idea there, just being taken up. Of course, it's a miracle. He wasn't taken to heaven. He was just removed from this particular physical place there as the Ethiopian went on home. You remember when we started our study in Acts and we were in chapter 1, and Jesus, before he ascended to heaven, gave the promise that the gospel would go to Jerusalem, to Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth through the ministry of the apostles after they were filled with the Holy Spirit. We read that and we think, and rightfully so, of the ends of the earth being the great global evangelism, and all the ministry that Paul is going to do as he brings the gospel to Europe. And yet the Jews, as we know, the Jewish Christians, Peter, John, and the rest, they didn't understand about the mission of the Gentiles right away, did they? When you read the end of the earth, to the Jewish mind in those days, we have references that the area of Ethiopia could be described as the ends of the earth. South of Egypt, down there in Africa, that's as far as civilization goes. So what we've seen here in Acts, as the gospel is given to the Jew first, we've seen the gospel in Jerusalem. Last week, as we began this chapter, we saw the revival in Judea and Samaria. And now, to the end of the earth, as the gospel is going to make it down to Ethiopia. What do we get next week? The salvation of the Apostle Paul. And who is he going to be? He's going to be the apostle to the Gentiles. And what do we see after that? We see the first Gentile, Cornelius, getting saved. You see the structure that the book of Acts is presenting for us. And this will end our dealings with Philip, basically, for the rest of the book of Acts. He only appears one other time, just as a aside, more in connection with his daughters than anything else, near the end of the book. But what a great man of the early church. And what made him such a great man? Well, there are two characteristics that really jump out. One, as we've seen, he's a man who is filled with the Holy Spirit and therefore led by the Holy Spirit. You see the emphasis throughout this passage, how the Spirit is guiding him, the Spirit is directing him. And secondly, he was a man of great faith. When God told him to leave the tremendous revival taking place in Samaria, he didn't argue. He didn't contest with God. He went. He obeyed. I can imagine the guys that he was ministering with saying, Philip, what are you doing? Are you sure you're hearing from God on this? Have you ever really heard God's voice and you know it doesn't contradict Scripture or anything? You say, this is God, and all your Christian friends just think you're nuts? Yeah, that doesn't make sense. But you know, this is what God wants in my life, what he wants for me. I'm sorry, Mom and Dad, it doesn't make sense to you. And I'm sorry, my good friends, Christian friends in school, and all that, it doesn't make sense to you. I know it's what God wants for me. And again, doesn't violate Scripture or anything. That was Philip. And he did it. He obeyed. He stepped out. And he met this guy, just one encounter. Very important encounter, yes, but that's it. That's all. And there are going to be times if we are people who will be led by God's Spirit and obedient when we hear his voice, that we will have just instances, moments, an hour, half hour, 5 minutes with somebody that you will never see again. And God wants you to take that 5 minutes with that person. As Paul wrote, one plants, one waters, God gives the increase. You have no idea. That little word, that little encouragement, that little witness was a stranger. Well, this guy was a stranger to Philip. very influential, powerful person in royal court. And the Lord speaks to his heart and says, why don't you go up and talk to that guy, see what's going on over there. And then he hears him, he's reading from Isaiah. He says, oh, now I know why you wanted me over here. But God didn't give him that when he was in Samaria. It would have been very easy if Philip was in Samaria and God says, I want you to go down to Gaza because you're going to meet this very influential Ethiopian guy in the court and you're going to lead him to Christ because he's going to be reading Isaiah 53. But God doesn't do that to us, does he? We walk by faith, not by sight. He doesn't give us all the details. He'll just be speaking to your heart one day while you seemingly are minding your own business and say, go pull yourself up to that person at the McDonald's that's sitting having lunch by themselves while you're having lunch by yourself and go strike up a conversation. What? They're a stranger to me. Huh? Who knows? And as we, as a people, as a church, are willing to be led by God's Spirit in such a way and seek to be led by God's Spirit. Wake up in the morning and say, Lord, use me. Have you ever prayed but then be afraid to pray it? Lord, use me to reach someone with Jesus today, but, you know, my kids or my wife or someone that's comfortable with me, someone friendly. Says, I got complete strangers out there I want to use you to minister to. All right, Lord, send me. Imagine if the entire church was doing that. What a difference our community, our country, our world would be like. That's an example we have from Philip here. This one chapter primarily is all we see of Philip. But what a great man. A man filled with the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, and a man who walked by faith, not by sight. And he helped change the world. May we, by God's grace, do the same. Let's pray.